Hello, I'm wondering if you've ever noticed when you go to an American bookstore, there's a very large self-help section. It's huge, about 10 meters worth of books. And if you go to a French self-help section, there is that does exist in their bookstores, but it's far smaller. And you might interpret that to mean that the Americans are kind of flipped out and need a lot of help, and the French are very centered. Well, the reality is there's simply less people who speak the French language. The economics of publishing in smaller languages, especially those that have lower incomes, becomes very difficult for the publishing industry. A few years back, I was doing a workshop with the World Bank on poverty alleviation, and one of the keys to lifting people out of poverty is literacy, especially amongst young girls from the ages of about 5 to 11 years old. And one aspect that's missing in that key period of life is there's often a lack of textbooks. Many of the world's languages don't have spelling books, math books, reading books, and the like. It's just a classic case of market failure. At the same time, I was working on some projects in development economics, dealing with foreign direct investment. A lot of people want to do impact investing, investing in developing countries to small businesses. Unfortunately, these businesses have very narrow business models. They might make 6-inch copper nails, things like that. Things for which there's actually no market data. You can't purchase data on the world market for some of these products and services. Again, a case of market failure. And being a professor of management science, I was kind of thinking about, well, is there any way to solve this market failure problem that seems to be not just for business investments, but also for language learning? And I discovered that there was demand. It was very narrow demand, but the key problem was actually the author. Authors are expensive. They want food and things like that. They want income. And there's also the editors and the graphic artists and all these people. And so appealing to management science, which was founded by Frederick Taylor, which is basically the use of mathematics to solve basic business problems, is there a way to augment labor productivity using management science techniques to overcome these market failures? And Frederick Taylor is given a lot of credit for starting the notion of automation. And in manufacturing, Ford, of course, took that to an extreme. So, question, can we replace the author with computer algorithms? You'll notice the acronym EVE here for something called a collection of programs, which is an economically viable entity that basically is a box that solves both of those problems simultaneously. And this is the basic problem. There's a world of information out there. Many of you have published articles or press, et cetera. And maybe the person that can most benefit from that research is on the other side of the planet. They don't read academic journals, they don't speak English, and they are in a world that has been underserved because of their small languages. How in the world can we get that information to them? But also, perhaps there's a wealth of knowledge on their side of the world that can be used on our side of the world in the world of data. So what is the sustainable model that I was considering and started working on a few years back? Very simply this, selling very expensive high-end market research studies, completely computer-generated, to subsidize the creation of language learning materials, mathematics books, et cetera, for the underserved languages or the long tail. This is what it actually looks like if you want to see a computer writing books. I've been doing this for about 10 years now. We've published over about 1 million titles. Most of them are high-end industry studies, but a lot of them are language learning. We've also done a number of different formats. Game shows, et cetera, weather reports for low literacy virus apps, Android apps and the like. So what are we working on exactly? It's looking for genres of human authoring that is very formulaic, but at the same time, highly impactful. If it's formulaic, then perhaps mathematical algorithms can imitate what human authors would do had they had the opportunity to publish in those underserved areas. So what is not formulaic is the question. I'm a dyslexic, so I collect dictionaries. We love those kind of things. This is one of my favorite in The Devil's Dictionary by Ambrose Bierce. Love, a temporary insanity curable by marriage. What is formulaic dictionary? The poor adverbs are the most underserved words in the dictionary. They don't get a lot of respect. And this frustrates people who are slow readers as well. You'll notice the head word is being defined by a word in the dictionary. Does that frustrate anybody? And then you have to look up the other word? Okay. Using computer algorithms, and I'll explain that how we did this in a minute. This is what EVE, the collection of programs, came up with as a definition for rurally in a rustic, agrarian, provincial, crude, or rough manner. second definition in an insolent, boorish manner, and third in a bucolic, pastoral, and idyllic manner. Using graph theory and a little bit of cluster analysis to come up with those definitions. With that knowledge, of course, one can create crossword puzzle books in any language because the computer doesn't know what language it's learning. Crossword puzzle books, test preparation guides. One thing in English as a second language learning, they use a lot of acrostic poetry. And you'll remember this from third grade. Try to find a word that defines the word that you're actually trying to use in the poem. In this case, God, we have a computer program that wrote about 4 million poems for sonnets and limericks and haiku. Then we have another program that acts as an editor that then judges the quality of those poems to figure out which ones to post online. And we've got 1.4 million of those. And this is the acrostic for God, gentleman of divinity, that passed through the algorithm. And the second one is love, lean of vile emotions. Okay. How did we do this? Leonard Euler, the famous mathematician, came up with this notion of graph theory, basically a semantic web of words that are related to each other in some kind of quantitative way. Zero, of course, doesn't have a powerful number there because it's used as a score 40 love in tennis. So it's not so related to the other words of love. I was approached a few years back, based on my language literacy programs, by the Gates Foundation to look at publishing in underserved areas in the field of agriculture. The world's poorest are in the field of agriculture, and they are in remote villages. One of our first things we did was actually install from all of the massive data out there in local languages, weather reports, crop, pests, and disease reports that are used in radio stations. This is Farmer Voice Radio that was broadcasting for the first time in villages the local weather. They had never heard the weather before. We got some very good feedback in terms of explanations of what do you mean by kilometers, what do you mean by degrees Celsius, et cetera. So a lot of programming had to go in to supplement that. We also worked with the Grameen Foundation in Uganda to create dashboards individualized for the various agricultural regions, synthesizing information that could not have been done very easily if it was done manually, working with direct connections to Africa, sending in textbooks that are now in local languages. The Anthill Foundation, this is a village in Uganda where the village had not yet had textbooks before. This was the day that the first one arrived, and you can see the children's heads pressed against each other. Definitely a demand for this kind of content. This is the most encouraging thing I found of this whole exercise. I believe the books will motivate even those who are currently not attending a school to go, which is a very encouraging insight. This is one of our funnest projects. This is a high-end 3D animation video game. Most languages do not have video games. This one is actually an output of an algorithmic engine. It can be played for any geography in the world. Given the world's soil conditions, climate conditions, etc., it imitates the agronomy of any location, and we've got algorithms that can look at Google Maps and actually give the actual terrain of the village where the game might be played. It's for agricultural extension workers to learn how to farm in areas that they may not have visited before. In terms of hardware, this is where we started. The future will be in your pocket. Your phones should be writing books for you pretty soon. They'll be writing PhD dissertations. Talk about formulaic, for anyone ever done it. The effects of X on Y, colon, a Z perspective. Speculation or discovery engines or minority reports telling us before a disease breaks out in a given region, what should be the plan of action or the call to action. Word 2.0, you ever been to a Word document and it's blank and you're going, gosh, I'd like to write a biography about my grandfather. You push a few buttons, do a few things, and boom, you've got a first draft. So maybe Word can write for us. And instead of Googling, maybe we can have a content engine. So when you type in bibliography subject X, it actually gives you one, and it's yours to reuse as much as you want with all rights clearance. And my favorite one is a physics textbook. When you're a child, often you don't like what you're reading. Do you agree? Physics books. But you want to be a football player. Why not have a football player physics book? Why not have a ballet physics book? There are thousands of subjects people are interested in. Why not have the context of what I'm most interested in, because now we can create these types of titles. If we can do the world's smallest languages, we can certainly do the world's smallest hobbies. Big data is big, but I think we should all demand more. Thank you very much.